Now, we've already talked about terminologies that we can actually communicate with each other, and we've talked about how to collect data. Now that we've collected data, what do you do with it? Well, the first thing that you typically want to do is look at the data. What does it mean to look at data? What does that mean? Well, typically, the idea of looking at the data means you could do some type of graphical display, a graph, create a graph of the data. That's extremely important. If you have a very large data set, say, well, actually, even 50 or 60 numbers, a small data set, looking at just the numbers, it can at times be extremely difficult to see what's going on in there. Now, think about a data set with 100, 200, 1,000, 10,000 different values in it. It's almost impossible to just look at a bunch of numbers on a piece of paper and say, oh, this is what's going on. That's just not going to happen. Hence the need for some type of graphical display, a graph of the data. Now, there are two major learning objectives that we need to talk about here. The first thing that we want to do is when we're done with this next series of videos, we want to be able to construct and interpret appropriate graphical displays for both qualitative and quantitative data. There's a slight difference in how this is done. And we want to better recognize and classify shapes of data. Shapes of distributions is extremely important. Based on the shapes of distributions later, that will help direct us to the type of analytical approach that we actually need to follow. So let's start off with creating what's known as a frequency distribution table. This is not really a graph, but it's a nice way to organize in preparation for a graph. And it's a nice way to organize the data into a tabular format that you can look at it and get an idea what's going on. So here's some grades. Like this B right here means that this particular student or a particular student received a B on an exam. That C means a particular student received a C in an exam, and so forth. So how do I want to do this? Well, I'm going to organize this in order from highest to lowest, highest being an A, lowest being an F. Now, clearly, this data is ordinal. The measurement scale is very important here. It's because the data is ordinal that I can put it in a logical order. So category the A, or first category is be the A's. How many A's do I have? Well, if I go through here, it looks like I have one, two A's. So the frequency is two. I observed two A's. Next, I will go to the B's. There's one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. So in this category, there are nine observed values, hence the frequency. Next, I'll take a look at the C's. Looks like there's one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. There are nine C's. Then my D's, there are one, two D's. And F's, looks like there's one, two, three. There's three F's. Now see, there's clearly an order here, A to F. You could have done it the opposite way, F to A's. And in a moment, it'll make sense why you may want to pick one or the other. Either way, there is an obvious order to this. Just clearly, this is ordered. If I add these up, see 2, 9, 9, 2, and 3, that should be 25. This is N. This is my total number. So now I'm going to deal with what's called the relative frequency. Well, relative to the entire group, the A's, there are 2 out of 25, which is 0.08. It's 8%. Relative to the group, the B's, there are 9 out of 25, which is 36%. Likewise for the C's, that's again 36%. The D's, 2 out of 9, which I already know is 8%. And the F's are 3 out of 9, which I already know. Which actually, I don't already know, that is 12%. Now, see, already I've organized this in a way that's useful. I know that 8% of the class got an A, 36% each got B's and C's, 8%, the same percent that got A's, got D's, and 12% failed. There's no way I could pick that up just by looking at those values in a table like this and be able to say anything important like I can now here. Now, the next column in this frequency distribution table is called cumulative frequency. So the first one is going to be a 2, and the next is 11. Okay, where do those come from? Well, who got A, or how many A's or better were there? Well, A is the first group. There are 2. Well, there are 9 B's. Well, how many got B's or better? 9 plus 2 is 11. C's, how many got a C or better? Well, 11 plus 9 is obviously 20. And then D's, D's are better. 20 plus 2 is 22. And then F's, that's everybody. 22 plus 3 is 25. And then we have cumulative relative frequency. That's the same idea as we did over here. This would be 2 out of 25, which we already know is 8%. This would be 11 out of 25, which is actually 44%. Now we have 20 out of 25, which is 80%. Then, of course, 22 out of 25, which is 88%. And last but not least, 25 out of 25, which is 100%. Now, see, this is extremely useful because now I can say, hey, 80% of the class passed this exam with a C or better. We can say that because of the natural order here. If this did not have order, we would not be able to make such a statement. But now we've actually produced something extremely useful from what started out to be really just a clutter. Now, fortunately, technologies such as most calculators, or some of the more advanced calculators, are TI-83, 84, and obviously TC Stats on the iPad will do all this for you. Here's a quick look at the exact same frequency distribution table that was created for the same data on TC Stats. And obviously, it went from A to F, just like we just did. The frequencies, relative frequencies as percentages, cumulative frequencies, and the relative cumulative frequencies, exactly the same thing that we just found. Now that we have that information, remember earlier I said the frequency distribution table is not a graph as such, but it's nice in that it helps us organize for a graph. I want to be able to produce a bar graph, and I'm going to do this by hand. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to set up my vertical axis and my horizontal axis, and I'm going to list my categories. So I could go from A to F, or F to A, either one. I think in this case, I'm going to turn it around and go F to A. So this would be my F, D's, C, B's, and A's. Now I'm going to look at my individual frequencies. They range from a small of 2 to a high of 9. So I'm going to set this up as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, a little bit short, 9, I would have liked to have gone to 10, but yeah, I should put 10 up there. Sorry, I kind of went into that writing, but you get the idea. Now, F's, there are 3 of them, so I'll go up to 3, and I'll simply make a bar. Now, I'll go to my D's, there were 2, so I'll go up to 2, and I'll make another bar. Now, there's something important here. On a bar graph, technically, there should be gaps in between these. That differs from a histogram, which we'll show you later when I'm using quantitative data. This is qualitative. They touch each other because technically it's on a continuum. You know, I don't want to get too much into the idea behind it because it's a little bit on the esoteric side, but technically, a bar graph, these should separate, and on a histogram, they touch each other. And actually, in some technology, they don't distinguish between them. So it's not a really big deal, but you should be aware of it. Let me see, the C's, there were 9, so I'll come all the way up here to 9, and I'll draw my bar. Now, something else that's very important is the width of these. The width here, and here, and here. These should all be the same width, as close as you can draw them. The problem is, if I make, let's say my A's, let's say I make my A's like this. Well, the eye, even though it's not as high, the eyes go see this as being bigger than this and think that it's a much bigger proportion than what it really represents. So that's definitely a bad idea. We always want the widths of these categories to be the same. Let me see, B's, there are also 9 B's. And there were 2 A's. Now, what I really recommend you do to help people read this is on the top here, I typically will write in the actual frequency. There's a 3. It's kind of obvious here, but and sometimes, like if you had 2, 4, 6, 8, whatever, sometimes it's a little bit difficult to see what the numbers are. So putting this in, I think, is very helpful to a reader. And another piece I think, helpful to a reader is if I put in that this is actually 12%, this is actually 8%, this is actually 36%, and so forth. See, now there's a bunch of very, very useful information in this graph. Now, the last thing that I need, I need a couple more things to finish this off. I need a title here. So I'm going to call this exam grades. And over here, I need to let people know that this is actually the frequencies. Now this graph is complete and it looks pretty good. Other than, sorry, I should have shifted it down. We don't want that in there. But other than that, pretty much everything that anybody could ever ask for in a graph like this is there. Now this is that exact same graph, that exact same bar graph done in TC Stats. And you notice TC Stats does not differentiate the fact that this is a bar graph, so they do touch. Technically they shouldn't, but like I said, most technology won't differentiate as such. But it's not that big of a deal. Now I want to produce a bar graph of hair color. This is a hair color that was collected from a class or something. So I have my categories. You see, brown. Let's make brown my first category. And how many are there? There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Looks like there's 13 of these guys. So that makes my frequency 13. What's next? Blonde. How many blondes? There's 1, 2. Looks like 3 blondes. And then how about, see, black? 1, 2, 3. It looks like there were 3 blacks. And then I have redheads. 1, 2. Looks like 2 redheads. Now, relative frequency. Well, if I add these up, I get a total of 21. So the relative frequency would be 13 over 21, 3 over 21, 3 over 21, 2 over 21. And which obviously we probably want to convert to percentages. 13 over 21 rounded is actually 62%. So I'm going to write this as 62% this time. And then 3 out of 21, again, rounded. It was 14.28, so I'll list this as 14%. And this will also be 14%. And then 2 out of 21 was 9.52%. So I'm going to write this at rounded as 10%. And in this case, when I add this up, I do get 100%. Sometimes when you start rounding, you won't get 100%. Now, in reality, I did this very quickly and easily. You probably want to, depending on which detail you're working with, that 62% for the brown hair was really 0.6190. As a general rule, we go up 4 places in this in my classes. So you may want to actually go out that far and call this 61.90%. It depends on what you're doing, or whether you need that much detail or not. Typically, it's a good idea to do that. Now, the cumulative frequency. Well, the cumulative and relative are cumulative relative frequencies. I'm going to put a big X to it. And in reality, if I was doing this for real, I would have never created the box, this table with these in there, because they don't make any sense. If I actually did the cumulative frequencies here, this would be 13. 13 and 3 is 16. So how would I interpret that? 16 people in that class have at least blonde hair. What does that mean? I have no idea. See, this has absolutely no meaning when we're talking about nominal data. And that's what this is. This is nominal. There's no order to it. When we looked at the grades, that was definitely ordinal. The grades as A, B, C's, and D's. And then the next obvious thing to do would be make a bar graph, which I'm not going to do here, but I think you get the idea. It'd be the exact same sort of thing that we did with the grades. Just create a vertical axis and then list your brown, blonde, black, and whatever, and just like we did with the grades. It's the exact same idea.